You should be able to feel the compression on all four of the cylinders. And it just doesn't feel like that at the moment. It's turning over too easily. For the engine to work, the fuel and air mixture needs to be compressed inside the cylinder. No compression means that air's escaping somehow, and I need to start taking the engine apart to find out why. You should never just hook up a battery and try to turn over a seized engine, as you could do more damage than the vehicle's worth. Take your time and work through the potential problems step by step. Most modern tractors and farm vehicles use diesel to run on, and actually lots of the old tractors used to run on a combination of petrol and paraffin. Ours is a little bit rarer because it uses just petrol, and I wonder if that might just make it a little bit more valuable too. That's no good. The valve is stuck open in the down position, and that's why the combustion chamber's not sealing. That's why we've got no compression. I imagine some of the others are the same. Got to go deeper into the engine. So, definitely one of the more basic engines that I've worked on in a while, but it's just about being methodical.
Lifting off the rocker shaft gives me access to the push rods and the cylinder block.
So I'm just making some holes in a bit of cardboard, so when we take the push rods out of the engine, we keep them all in the right order.
Push rods open and close the valves that let the fuel and air in and exhaust gases out of the cylinders.
So, 8 push rods, 8 holes in the cardboard. So, yeah, I can see that the valve stem and I imagine the guide going through the top of the cylinder head. It's all a bit corroded, a bit rusty, and that'll be why it's sticking. They need cleaning up.
A version of this engine was used for cars as well, so parts are still readily available. But I'm hoping a bench grinder will bring these valves back up to scratch.
Much better. It might be difficult to take apart modern motors yourself, but the basic principles apply to all engines. So working on an old one like this is great, as you can easily strip it back and really get to see how it all works.
I retraced my steps to put the engine back together, just the high tension leads to go.
So getting the firing order correct, getting these leads connected up in the right order is really important because the engine pushes its pistons up and down in a particular order, and so the spark needs to be delivered to that cylinder at exactly the right moment. If you get it wrong, it'll be chaos. There'll be flames coming out of the exhaust, there'll be sparks when we don't need them, fuel being compressed but not ignited, and it just won't work. And quite luckily, on this old engine, the firing order is imprinted on the side of the block, which is very handy. The ignition key is made out of an old bent nail. You wouldn't believe it, but this rusty old indicator-like stalk is actually the hand throttle on this thing. And to start it, it's this gear lever down here. Nothing. Something just isn't quite right yet.
This Fergie's taken up an enormous amount of time and energy, and it's still not running.
I took the tank off, I cleaned it all out, I put fresh fuel in, but one thing I didn't do is check the fuel lines, and there is every chance, having had this thing sat for 40-odd years, there could be dirt and dust and rubbish that seeped down from the tank into the pipe and is stopping the fuel getting into the cylinders.
Once the fuel line's unhooked, a quick blast with compressed air should hopefully flush out any debris.
It doesn't take a lot to block these narrow fuel lines. And you can see it, look at that, all over this bit of tissue. And if that's sat in there, we won't be getting fuel into the cylinder, and that could be the reason it's not firing up. My goodness, I thought it might be a bit smoky, but that's quite a bit.